All right, so our next speaker is Zara Kay, a Tanzanian Australian ex-Muslim atheist activist and the founder of Faithless Hijabi.
So I didn't actually have a speech prepared, just thought I'd rock up and see how the conversation goes. But I woke up this morning thinking about what I'd say, and I was trying to identify that one moment that I had when I had given up on my faith. The one defining day or that moment that it just clicked when I'm like, okay, I'm an atheist now, or I don't believe in God. And I couldn't think of it. So I went back and, you know, I went back in my memories and tracked the first time I questioned God. And it was when I was really young, I was 14. And I kept asking my parents, where's God's family? Who created God? And just questions like these slowly was when I gradually gave up on what was meant to be my life's purpose or what I was meant to continue to pass on to future generations and other people. And after I came out as an ex-Muslim, I was, you know, it was that question, how did you tell your family? Did you even tell your family when you immediately came out? I think it took me several months before I could even voice my opinions about not believing in God, let alone, being an ex-Muslim. I was always progressive in nature. Like I was always pro-LGBT, anti-homophobic views, anti-sexist views. And my family thought, you know, this is a phase, it'll pass, it'll go away. She'll become more religious. This is all Western influence because she lives in Australia. So I was born in Tanzania and I moved out when I was 16. And I, you know, I came out to them 2017. And I told them, I'm an atheist, or I think I'm agnostic, but I don't believe in God. I don't think he exists. And I went through anxiety. I went through a very anxious period. And my family said, it's because you don't believe in God. I think you should pray harder. And maybe, you know, you'll find your way back. And that just angered me. And I was an ex-Muslim, but I was not ready. Like, I still had my views out in public, and I was not ready to do a podcast. My first podcast was with Secular Jihadists, with Amin, actually. And I remember what I used to say in my first podcast. I was still so shy from voicing my opinions against Islam because I didn't want to come off as anti-Islamic. I didn't want to feed into anti-Muslim bigotry, and that is not what I do. But it can, a lot of times, it is very, it overlaps unless you clarify it. You can criticize ideas, but not people. So when I was in a room where Harris was debating with Uthman Badr from Hizb ut-Tahrir, and that was possibly that one moment that I knew that I had to be an activist when he said apostates should be killed. And I interjected in the end, and I remember how furious I was. And I had to question his position from the audience. And I'm like, what do you mean by that? You're in Australia. And you want Sharia law to be applied in Australia or around the world, and Sharia law states that apostates should be killed. Is that correct? And he's like, yes. And I'm like, so you're saying that apostates and people, like half of us in this room, should be killed? And, you know, he tried going around it, but that's when I realized that there are people like this that exist, and we need to fight against it. So I did my first podcast with Secular Jihadists, and then I had a chat with Harris, and that was great. I came out, I got to voice my opinions. It came with a lot of backlash because a lot of people knew my family back home. My family were embarrassed to go out. I've been sexually harassed so many times. Just day before, I got somebody sending me a message saying atheism is just another way to promote your prostitution. I took off my headscarf way before I renounced religion. It just felt uncomfortable to me. And when I took it off, I was told I was naked because I wasn't covering my hair anymore, or that I had no self-respect. And my sister said I did not value myself because I was showing my arms to men. And these were the little things that brought me to open Faithless Hijabi, because while there was ex-Muslims and there were ex-Muslim community, there wasn't a platform or a safe space for more women to share their stories without being ridiculed without having, you know, without actually having a woman another woman understand, I know I've been through this and I want to help. So as brave as I did, as brave as I thought I was, I did it, and it grew bigger than I thought. And, you know, I started it in October while having talks about it in July. And ever since, we've had hundreds of women giving out their stories in confidence. And, you know, I post them up anonymously. And what I found among all these women is their questioning phases started very much like mine. It was this progressive thought. It was the anti-women thought, the anti-women idea that was promoted in Islam that slowly led them to start questioning even more of the theological part of Islam. That, you know, it started questioning what was Muhammad thinking when he said that women are half of men in testimony when it comes to giving their testimony in court. Yes. But what was also Muhammad thinking marrying Aisha at the age of 6, right? He had multiple wives. He had sex slaves. Why marry a 6-year-old? And the mental gymnastics we face with that, just that one story, is that she hit puberty. She was not 16. Age was not a thing then. She was 19. Different sources quote different things. No, everybody knows it was child marriage. Why are you trying to rationalize it? And there were little things like this that pushed women away from Islam. And more women are now speaking out. So with Faithless Hijabi, I don't know how much time we have. I know. Okay, perfect. Okay, perfect. I wanted to start reading out a story that was sent to me to Faithless Hijabi. So I picked out one from the hundreds that I have. So she wrote to me and she said, I was born in Dubai. I was forced to wear a hijab at the age of 11. But I rebelled. Sadly, that didn't last longer because of the threats, and that became harsher. I wasn't allowed to go out. I wasn't allowed to go on the internet. I got physically, mentally, and sexually abused by my own family. I left Islam knowing all that, apart from the sexual abuse, Islam had justified it, and that the guardian isn't punished on the day of judgment. And because of this, I started reading deeply about the religion. I left it at the age of 17. I told my mom. Her reaction wasn't good at all. She forced me to pray. I couldn't continue college because they wanted a major with less men in it. I wasn't allowed to drive only until marriage. And speaking of marriage, when the opportunity came up, when my parents were questioning marriage, I said no, and I was told that it wasn't none of my business, that I had no choice. I couldn't endure all of this, so I left my country and sought asylum in France. I know that my country does not provide any rights for women. And in France, I was reborn. The feeling of when the sun rays hit my legs for the first time, I was in shorts. Listening to music being played on the streets, walking around without the fear of getting caught by one of your siblings. These things are unforgettable and precious memories for me. However, I'm still trying to rebuild my life after the abuse I've dealt with. This is, yes, a story from a Middle Eastern girl who left and sought asylum in France, but it's not limited to just women who are in the Middle East. It is very much so a problem for women in the West, in Muslim communities. I think a lot of times we always look, like Armin mentioned, that, you know, a lot of times Rahaf is always in the spotlight for being an ex-Saudi woman, but she's also an ex-Muslim, and a lot of the media failed to acknowledge that. A lot of the media did not even talk. The episode in Four Corners, I encouraged, because I was kind of part of that, you know, helping Rahaf get out. I kept saying this. I know a lot of media won't focus on it. It's not only the issue of her leaving Saudi. The issue is that she's left Islam, right? And all the backlash that she got, not only from Saudi men, from other Muslims as well. You know, they're like, yeah, look, you know, Saudi is a horrible regime. And like, I'm glad that you're fighting against it. But like, why did you leave Islam? Like, Islam is great. But, you know, and I'm like, Islam is a peaceful religion. And, you know, there's so many rights for women. So I dug into it further and I started talking to more Saudi women. And I'm like, let's clarify this. What is happening? How many atheists are there in Saudi? How many Muslim women want to escape because they're atheists, not only because of the Saudi rules? And what I found out is there are plenty. There are plenty of women that are atheists because it's when it starts off with ideas such as abuse, they look deeper into it. When you empower women to know their rights, they're then empowered to fight for it. And this is how I feel that we can destroy Islam or we can come out of it. And it always starts up by a personal story. It starts up by an experience for most, at least in my experience, and the girls that have sent me their stories. It started off by the sexism that they had faced, the inequality in rights, and then it transcended over the historical and the theological part of it. And, you know, I think Australia has just not done enough in recognizing these minorities. We've just not received, even as ex-Muslims, men or women, we've not received enough support. You know, we've not trained psychologists, social service caseworkers on how to approach this. I went and I saw a psychiatrist when I had anxiety, and he was a Muslim, and I was like, maybe he'll understand why I came out, right? I was a fool. I thought he would understand, but I remember in Ramadan when I said something about Muhammad, he said, "Touch wood, this is blasphemous," and that destroyed me and that shattered me. And obviously, I never saw him again. But you know, while he was trying to be as professional as he could be, there was so much. It's so hard being from a religious background to even understand ex-Muslims, and this is why I think these conferences are a really good start. For us not only to talk to people who agree with us, but to disagree with us. At the very least, get support from even the Muslims to go like, hey, I accept you for a choice. And I think that is a slow progress for us to move into a tolerant society. And I'm going to open the floor up for questions because I feel there might be more. Go for it.
When I said you've got ex-Muslim and you've got atheist, I don't see them being totally one and the same in interpretation. So have you thought of potentially reaching out to other religious groups for support?
So that is, answer that question. So reaching out for other religious groups is just saying, get out from one cult and go into another. When I posted up on Twitter about my Islamic views, and there were Christians and Hindus who reached out to me, they're like, Islam is barbaric, but Christianity is not. And I'm like, really? Is any religion not misogynistic or sexist? Is any religion going to give me the equal rights that men have? Have any women who've left religion received the same dignity after they've left it as compared to men? And this is what we'll discuss more in detail on the Islam and feminism thing. Well, there is the concept of community that we all lack, that we all need, or some of us need when we leave Islam or any religion. It's not limited to getting into another religion. I have friends. I joined the Underground Australian Ex-Muslim group. And then, you know, even then I made my other friends. I didn't need that sense of community to be a whole. I started creating that community within my friends. Even those who don't, I have Muslim friends as well who don't agree with me and do not like that I'm voicing my opinions against Islam. But it took us a while. While most of them abandoned me, ostracized me, abused me, and even said that I should be killed. I had a poll up on Instagram saying, should blasphemous laws be punishable? They said, a lot of them, 80% said yes. And they posted a photo of me smiling, and I'm like, should I be killed because I'm blasphemous? Well, 92 people said no. A big number, about 32, including my childhood friends, said yes. And someone even when I talked about my anxiety, I'm very open about my mental health, and I talked about it, and some of them even said that because you have anxiety, I hope you commit suicide, and that will be God's way of punishing you, so you can stop talking against God, or stop talking against Islam. And that was, I had to shut down for a week after I received that. I don't think people realize that those negative comments have a very traumatizing, are very traumatizing experiences for us. So no religious group can ever fill up that gap when you essentially do not believe in God.
Sorry, I want to jump in. I know it seems hard for you to overlap the two, atheism and ex-Muslim, but maybe it'll be easier if you see ex-Muslim as a subset of atheism rather than a separate category. It's just a subset.
I was just thinking more of you sort of looking for more support.
Why would you seek support from the context you've left?
Sir,
it's not so much you have to go join another religion. I'm just saying that there are, like, say for example, gay rights in Australia. There are sort of
I.
But that's a whole different ideology.
Can I interject? Sorry. Yes. So I understand your question in terms of support, but that is only enabling other religions to then take over the vulnerable ex-Muslims that have come up, right? That is only pushing for them from one group to another. Our issue, our violence is also one of the issue, but that's not limited to it. But I will get back to you on more questions after this. Go for it.
As I just said, we are going to have a contribution later from ex-Muslims who are not atheists.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, we have something coming up after. But yes, not in my experience, most ex-Muslims that have come out to me are all atheists. And when you don't believe in God, why would you go to another group for support when you already have that fundamental contradicting values that you do not believe in God or any dogmatic beliefs? And I'm time out, but I will be available for questions after. Thank you.